Raise your hand if you're glad to be here on a day when the temperature will not surpass your body temperature. Woo! All right. Amazing if you're outside last night, how good that feels. It's really shocking. Must be in the 70s and you're running, it's 96. And whoa, it's amazing. When Wendy and I were preparing to move to Texas, we had been in student ministry in East Tennessee for a decade. And right before I left, I thought I'd try something new that I had never tried before. And so I approached a group of about five junior and senior high school students who were kind of on the verge of leadership. They had the ability, they had the gift, but they had never quite stepped into that. And I tapped them on the shoulder and said, guys, I will meet with you once a week at 6 a.m. for breakfast and teach you everything that was taught to me if you want it. All of them showed up for 6 months at 6 a.m. right before school, and we spent time just talking through what I had been taught. And sometimes it was awkward. They'd want to talk about girls or cars. I kind of had a plan with the Bible. But then other days, they would completely derail it. And somebody, I remember Hunter saying, Steve, there's this girl I want to date, but I'm not sure if I should. What do you think? And I remember one of the guys saying, my mom hates this church, and my dad loves this church, and I'm really tired of being in the middle. What do I do? And one of the guys said, I'm thinking about the Coast Guard. What do you guys think? And one of the guys, all the guys, said, there's this thing I'm struggling with that a lot of guys do alone, and I'm not sure if God can still use me. It's an amazing time. It lit a fire in me. I gained some weight because we would eat quesadillas at 6 a.m. And I gained this group of disciples for those last 6 months when we were there. I didn't know that discipleship was that easy. I'd always gotten into that trap of having a class or a program, and those things can work, but sometimes it's just amazing how simple it can really be when you just take some time and listen and answer questions. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I use the word disciple and discipleship a couple of times. That's kind of a loaded church word. We throw it around a lot. We don't always spend a lot of time with, well, what does that word mean and where does it come from? And before I answer that, before I give us a definition, I want to throw three big things up here on the wall. And we're going to come back to these in a minute as we look through Scripture. Three things that I've learned, that people have taught me, that God has taught me over these past almost 20 years in ministry. The first is that everybody wants to be discipled. Everybody. The second is that nobody feels qualified to actually do it. And the third is that it's always been that way. And I think I can prove it. Or better, I think the Apostle Paul can prove it for us, our most interesting man, as he writes to us near the end of his life in these three little letters tucked away at the back of the New Testament. If you flip to Revelation and back up a little bit, you'll run into 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus. Three letters to these two men Paul was discipling. Two guys he had poured his life into. So flip over there, and as we do that, we're going to hit those three big questions or three big ideas. Everybody wants to be discipled. Nobody feels qualified to do it. It's always been this way. And as we go through, I think we'll see Scripture speak to those ideas and tell us a little bit of what to do about it. Now, our problem with the discipleship word starts with Jesus. He used it. He threw this word into this big statement he made, really dramatic exit from the planet. And his final commission to we his people was here in Matthew 28. And he said it like this. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you until the very end of the age. Make disciples. What's a disciple? You'll hear the word tossed around if you've been in church for any time at all. In Greek, you get the word mathetes, disciple. It's the idea of being, and here's where it gets really complicated. Okay, you ready? A student. A learner. That's it. We stick this big Christian word on it, and it feels so complicated, but the word means learner, student. My wife has disciples. She has students. She's a first grade teacher. She has a whole room for of them, and they're kind of annoying. She likes them better than I do. I'm sorry, first graders. You'll forget that as you age. They have boogers. Sometimes they eat them. They tattletale, and they hurt themselves a lot. And she has this amazing remedy for first graders who hurt themselves. She gives them a wet paper towel. Here you go, honey. Here's a wet paper towel. It's amazing how powerful that is. It just, thank you, Miss Pruitt. It helps. And they interrupt her. She's got some that just get up, walk around while she's talking. They make all kinds of mistakes. And you know what? She doesn't mind. They're students. They're learning. That's why she's there. They act just like first graders. And when Jesus uses this word, I think we overestimate his opinion of us sometimes. We're students, learners. His commission to us was to help other people learn to follow me. Help learn to follow Jesus. In verse 20, he hints at it. He says, teach them to observe all I've commanded you. They're learning. We're learning how to follow. A process. And we're in process. And I think it's kind of built into who we are as people. We all want to learn. And that's why I say something so crazy. Everybody wants to be discipled. Now, everybody doesn't know that Jesus is the piece they're really looking for. But everybody wants to learn, to grow, to know what to do next, or to see somebody do it in front of them. And I didn't always believe this, but a few years ago, I started trying it out. Whenever I meet new people and I've got opportunity, I try to assume that they want to grow. And so many times, I'll ask a question. And you can ask all kinds of questions, but you can often get clues from a tattoo or a name or a photo of a child on a waitress's badge or a ring on somebody's finger or just the type of career that you're visiting with to ask some semi-informed question about their life. And the amazing thing is most people, if you take a moment to ask a question about their life or how they got into what they're doing, they will answer you. It's remarkable. Most people will take a minute and answer the question. And many times, by doing so, give you permission to ask a second question, like, wow, that's interesting. What do you think about that? Or, my favorite, this will make you feel, you'll seem really wise. People will tell you how wise you are if you just start asking this question. What are you going to do? Nobody ever asks that question. Nobody ever says, what are you going to do next? And it's amazing. You usually get a blank stare, and people will go, how did you know to ask that? Because nobody asks. Nobody cares. Everybody's so busy trying to tell their own story. It's so incredibly rare when somebody stops long enough to ask. And it assumes that you have a decision to make. There's a tiny little interchange going on in that moment where you say, what are you going to do? It assumes you're going to get to decide what's next in your life. It helps you to think about it. And people don't mind that if it's genuine. Jesus did that quite a bit. When you read through the stories of him here on earth, he asked a lot of questions. Now, there's a trick to this, and the trick is there isn't a trick. He cared. He meant it. If he asked the question, he was genuine. He assumed that he was going to take time to listen to the answer. He wasn't just checking something off a list or targeting people. He wanted to know the answer. We'll hit more of that later. It doesn't work if it's fake. And this comes up with Timothy and Titus. As Paul's writing to them, he's going to begin to explain in his own way that everybody is worthwhile. Everyone is worthwhile. They're worth your time. It'll show up in 1 Timothy in the second chapter when Paul starts to speak, and I'll read it in just a minute, but watch this, because he's going to explain to them that everybody wants to be discipled because Jesus wants to disciple everybody. Everybody wants it because Jesus wants everybody. Let's read it. Watch this. Watch for the word all. 1 Timothy 2:1. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. You were made for this. You're made for a relationship with Jesus. And once you have that, you were made to help others begin to be students of Jesus just as you are. It's the heart of God. All people. All people. All people. Be saved and, isn't this interesting? He splits it. Be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. There's an entry point into faith, but there's also a deepening as you learn who Jesus, as you become a student of Jesus, of the truth. It starts so often in the New Testament with lost people, and Jesus uses the word lost because he describes lost coins and lost sheep. When he says lost, he means precious, people who are precious to him. And then it starts to include all of us, not only the lost, but those who have made the entry into faith and are growing in the process of coming to know him. Our staff here at Bentree, on Wednesday, we went through this evangelism training process. And it was really interesting for the whole staff. And one of the things that showed up, and this is a little difficult, for those of us in church, many of us no longer know any lost people. It's a problem because we have Jesus and he wants everybody. And we don't know any of them. But Paul addresses this. He tells us what to do right there in that first verse. Pray. Pray. Pray for opportunities. Now, if you start to do that, this will mess with you. You will come home and say, I can't believe I had that same cashier. All she wants to do is talk while I'm in line. You come home from work. I've had the same employee for 10 years. How dare he come in my office and want to talk about his marriage coming apart? When you start to pray for opportunities, God will show you that he's had people all around you. And he's been looking for them. He's been seeking them. He loves them. He wants them. Waiters and cashiers, employees, classmates, roommates, neighbors. And you start to listen to the Holy Spirit. He'll start to tap on your shoulder and say, you've known this one for several years, and you guys drive the same car. I've given you a way to start the conversation. Your kids play soccer on the same team, and I've got you ready. As soon as you're ready to listen, I want to show you what to do and what to say. You're surrounded by people who want to tell their stories if somebody would listen. But here's the problem. You probably don't feel qualified, right? Nobody feels qualified. The Apostle Paul, Paul the brilliant, Paul the disciple, not qualified. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12, when he's setting up the letter to his disciple Timothy, he says it this way, I thank him who has given me strength. Paul didn't have strength. Jesus gave him strength. He wasn't qualified. He needed strength from Christ. Christ Jesus, our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service, though formerly I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, an insolent opponent. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. A paraphrase. I received mercy from Christ because I was a fool. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. Paul's credentials for Timothy were, Timothy, I was a fool. Jesus gave me mercy and strength. I was the chief of sinners. Yet Timothy wasn't qualified either. In chapter 4, in the same letter, Paul says, and you've heard the first part of this, I want to make sure you hear the ending. He says, "Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech and conduct and love and faith and purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. Don't neglect the gift you have, which was given you by prophecy when the council of elders laid their hands on you. Practice these things, immerse yourself in them." And here's the part I want you to see. "So that all may see your progress." Paul's instruction to young Timothy was, let people see this truth of Christ change you. You don't have it together, Timothy. You don't have it. You don't have to have it together. Let people see it affect your life as you, a student of Christ, learn and grow. It's your progress. It's your own walk with Him that will give you credibility in other people's lives. Let them see the vulnerable pieces. Just like, Timothy, I modeled for you in the first chapter when I explained, you know, hey, I didn't have strength. Jesus gave me strength. Nobody feels qualified because nobody is qualified. Nobody feels qualified. Nobody is qualified. I used to avoid asking people if I could disciple them because I thought it felt really arrogant. "Well, would you let me teach you what I know, young Padawan? You call me master." And it felt really arrogant. And Paul, he started out with his weakness. And so I said to this group of guys, my quesadilla club, I'll share all my mistakes. I'll tell you all the failures and how Jesus met me in those. And you guys can ask me anything, anything. Nothing's off limits. They all said yes. And they did. Our young adult ministry, many of you know we have a thing on Thursday night, and a community of 20-somethings growing here. What you may not know is that the leadership team of that community are all 20-somethings. And I meet with them every Tuesday morning at 7. It's central time, so we don't do 6. That seems just a little too early. But at 7, we meet for coffee out in the crossing. And while I was gone this summer, they've been working on goals and dreams for that community this next year. And they wrote this down, and here's a little excerpt from it. One of their goals is discipleship. And they said, "Leadership is accountable," leadership being them. They're talking about themselves. "Accountable to disciple at least one person who could fill their shoes should he or she leave their leadership position. Our hope," the second part, "is that modeling this will lead to duplication, thereby fostering an environment of discipleship." The 20-somethings at Bent Tree saying, well, we will need to be this to encourage those around us who also don't feel qualified because they're unqualified, but they're willing. So last week at 7, I said to them what I said to the Quesadilla Club, I would love to see you guys that same way, and I'll share with you whatever was taught to me and any of the mistakes I've made. You can ask whatever you want. And they looked at me and they said, Steve, that's what we wanted all along. Everybody wants it. Nobody feels qualified. But Jesus wants everybody, and Jesus is qualified. He just needs your vulnerability. It's always been this way. That's why Paul writes Timothy and Titus to encourage them. Titus is this bold leader in Crete. He's training leaders and he's planting churches. Timothy is this timid leader. You can remember Timothy in Ephesus, and he's training leaders and planting churches. They both needed encouragement from their mentor, Paul. It was difficult. It took a toll. There's this passage in Timothy, we get a hint of what he was like. In chapter 5, verse 23, Paul says, "No longer drink only water, but use a little wine." This is your favorite verse for some of you. "Use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments." Timothy was frail. Nobody was ever up to this task. It's always felt overwhelming and frightening. It's always been this way because discipleship is difficult. It's always been difficult teaching others to follow Christ because it's impossible. We can't do it. We really can't do this. But here's the big but. Jesus can in us and through us. And Paul tells Timothy in his second letter, chapter 1, verse 7, Timothy, who struggled with timidity and fear and frailty in his body. He says, Timothy, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Power, love, and self-control. Three things you absolutely don't need if you live in a cave or a bubble. But if you live around other humans, three amazing gifts from the Holy Spirit that speak to the heart of God. Power, in Greek, it's dunamis. It means ability, capability. The first of these things that we see in the Spirit given to Timothy is the ability. Because we don't have it, the Spirit does have the ability. He is able to teach. And then love, agape. People can smell fakes, right? You have to actually care. And you may need some time here. If your heart feels so far away from the people that you think God may be tapping your shoulder to speak to, you start praying about this. Get honest with God and what's going on in your heart. Many of us, as we get a little older, our kids get in school and then high school and college, and you look around, you realize your life is absolutely full of all kinds of obligations, and what kind of drifted off your plate were these other people, and you realize somewhere down the road, hey, you are the 40-year-old or 50-year-old, just like the one who poured into you when you were 20. And sometimes you got to pray through that and say, Lord, I feel overwhelmed with my own life, but I remember those who did this for me. Help my heart connect with your heart here. And then self-control. In Greek, it's sophronismos. Sophronismos. I can't actually speak Greek like Paul. Sophronismos. It's hard to translate. We get self-control. Some of your translations, you'll see discipline. A better word is a really old word, prudence. It's knowing when to speak, when to act. The Spirit that God has given us knows when to speak. He knows what to say. Paul reminds Timothy, Timothy, you've been given a spirit who knows what to say and knows when to say, even if you don't. And people will test this. They'll test the love before they open up. One of my first conversations with a friend of mine, I was a meeting at Starbucks. He wanted to start to hear about Jesus. He wanted to understand who Jesus was. But in our conversation, he first tested me to see if he was going to listen to what I had to say. And he said it like this. I know you got your kids with you, so you listen close. He said, Steve, later tonight, I'm cooking dinner for my boyfriend's family. Did you catch that? And the Spirit, through me, said, so, you like to cook? Yeah. People want to know if you actually care first. And we've been friends for over a year. He let me teach him who Jesus was. And he's in process. Sometimes people test it to see if you really do have agape for them. This is difficult. Discipleship is difficult for the believer. But it is normal when the Spirit of God lives inside you. You will never feel qualified. You'll often feel afraid or unprepared, and it can be really expensive. I mean, think about how this passage started. Jesus Christ was ransomed for all. It's really, really expensive. And in your own life, it will sometimes cost you time and sleep. Imagine what the Spirit says in you when your friend calls at 1 in the morning and says, I need a sober driver. I've got a friend, and it's costing her money. She's actually hiring a gal she's discipling because she needs a way to provide some financial assistance, but wants to do it in a way that honors her ability to work and earn parts of that. One of my friends in our young adult community, I gave him my trust, and he stole from my family. And we had to work through that whole thing. It kind of hurt. And he's been growing in the process. We've actually pulled him out of leadership for a little while we got him some help and then reintroduced him to the community there with his whole story out in front of them and his vulnerability so they can see his progress like Timothy. Sometimes it hurts more than that. Sometimes the people you pour your heart and your life into that you love dearly, sometimes they divorce. And sometimes they move away. Alex moved away recently, but we're not done. And sometimes it's permanent. Sometimes they die. Among those who I've poured my heart out for, I have one die in a drunken car wreck, one die from murder, one die from suicide. And then there was Ben. Ben was one of my quesadilla guys. Every Monday at 6 in the morning, I had this amazing smile and this really, really gentle heart. He was wondering if the Coast Guard was what he was made for. And I hadn't heard anything for years since we left Tennessee. And last summer, some friends got in contact with me and let me know that Ben had made a decision. He had gone into the Air Force to a pararescue unit, and I didn't know what that was, but these are the guys who, when soldiers have been wounded in combat, right in the middle of it, they jump in helicopters and go get them while they're being shot at. That was what Ben had been doing when his helicopter was shot down in Afghanistan, and he died. And this past week, when I was looking back into this story, I found out something I didn't know. Tattooed on Ben's back were these words of Jesus: "Greater love has no man than that he lay down his life for his friend." It's so difficult sometimes, pouring out your heart, letting the Spirit love through you. But if Jesus is in you, then it's like breathing. We're compelled. We have a spirit of power, of love, of prudence. But life looks like that when you're following Jesus, when you're learning. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says to Timothy, and watch this, he says, "Timothy, what you have learned from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." Do you see that? Paul to Timothy, to faithful men who can teach others. There's four generations in that little bitty verse, that this is a normal cycle and process, as what was taught to you is passed down to those who come after you. The same thing happens in Titus chapter 2. Paul tells Titus, make sure you teach the older men to teach younger men. Make sure you teach the older women to teach the younger women. Read these books. These are amazing pieces into the life of the disciple Paul as he discipled others who discipled others. It's this tiny roadmap we get in these three little letters, where instead of a letter to the church, we get to narrow in on one person as they learn to follow Christ. Is always this hand back out to those who preceded you. And by the way, those who preceded you, sometimes they need you. It gets hard and lonely. And as you grow, you gain the ability to encourage those who mentored you. But also a hand behind to those who are coming after you. It's just a normal part of the process as Christ teaches us to follow. This past summer, Wendy and I got to go back to Tennessee for a couple of weeks. And 8 years after I left the Quesadilla Club, I went and visited a church that had been planted by some friends of mine. There's about 300 people on the second floor of an old building downtown, and they sat in a big circle, and the middle of the room is where the microphone was. And as I sat there, seeing so many familiar faces, this bearded man in plaid stood up, walked to the microphone, and he welcomed us. And he told us about his hope for this church and his hope for Christ in my life. And later on, during a break, he looked at me and he smiled at me, and I recognized his eyes. It was Stephen. He was one of my quesadilla guys. In the cycle, pouring out his life now into other people. The cycle that's demonstrated in Timothy and Titus. Everybody wants to be discipled, because Jesus wants everybody. So pray. Take time and ask the questions that nobody asks people. Nobody feels qualified because nobody is qualified. So listen to the Spirit who lives in you, who is able, who has love, who has prudence and knows what to say, when to say it. And it's always been like that because it is difficult. But when the Spirit of God lives inside you, it is normal. And it becomes like breathing with the Spirit. Amen? Amen. Thank you guys so much for being with us this morning. We pray that you have a blessed Labor Day. I'll see you guys next week.